Should I upgrade my camera? One of the most favorite questions among photographers. And this topic, I fully explored this and made it into a tutorial not too long ago in my premium courses. I want you to enjoy this now on YouTube so that you have an idea how good my premium courses are. Premium courses is one of my most popular courses of e-learning in my website here. More about premium courses later on. Hi, the age-old question, do you really need to upgrade your camera and equipment? Let's go through a few points and let's see whether we should really upgrade our camera. I think the first thing we should consider is how much has camera technology progressed over the years? And that's a very valid, good point for you to evaluate and see whether the camera that you are owning now, how old has it been since you first bought it? Well, let's give you a comparison. You see, the D600 was launched in 2012, and then the successor, the D750, 2014, 2 years later. And it takes another 6 years before you get to the 780, which is launched in 2020, this year. Now, let's look at a few important points. I'm going to talk about the exposure, and then I'm going to talk about the advancement in your focusing, and then the third one would be the video. If there's anything progress in a camera, that's not much. It's either the exposure, the focusing, or the speed of the camera. The photos would not just, or the colors would not just become revolutionary nicer. Let's talk about exposure. This is the native ISO of each camera. So as you can see, there's a gain of 2 stops. Wait, when I say native ISO, I just learned today from my producer that native ISO means that when you turn your Nikon camera to the maximum ISO, you see a number, and if you keep on turning, you get this high one, high two. These are not native. These are native ISO. That means the highest the camera can go naturally in ISO without digital boost. Let's look at this. This is 6400. It sounds logical to be using a native ISO that high. I wouldn't even go higher. But look at the D780's native ISO, 51200. That's crazy. Why would you need an ISO that high? Personally, I find that you shouldn't be shooting at a high ISO like this, because it is not just about boosting your ISO or adding the lights. You see, when you add the lights, a few things happen. You brighten up the location. Secondly, you bring out contrast and separation between the subject and the background. And thirdly, when you have enough of light, that's where you get colors. So when you're boosting ISO only, even by 2 or 3 stops, like it or not, you end up with a bit of noise. And you're still not creating that separation. And you tend to get muddier color, no matter how good your ISO is. So I am not really impressed with the ISO increment. But let's move on. Let's talk about your focusing. Focusing for photography remains almost the same for all these three models. They still have the AFS, AFA, and then you still have the AFC. While there is not much increment in the speed of focusing, but the number of focus points increase. Well, unless you're a sport photographer, then that would make a big difference. However, when it comes to focusing for video, yes, there's a dramatic improvement, but we'll talk about video separately. Let's talk about the speed of the camera. When I say speed of the camera, it means two things. The acquisition, how fast when you click and then the camera go on a burst mode and get you those pictures. These are the numbers. Well, this only matters if you're out there showing off to some girls that you got a new camera and go, or you're a sports photographer, yes. But if you're a sports photographer, the D780 may not be even fast enough. I promise you I'll talk about focusing for videos. Yes, the D780 has a really fast video focusing. It's really accurate. The rest, they are pitiful. If you're going to be shooting video and then you want to upgrade, I can promise you the past 2 years, the camera technology in video focusing is really good. So in summary, let's talk about the improvement on the two major things. Your exposure, the ISO. That's what you're looking at. 3 from the 600. Dynamic range, that means the discerning ability of your camera from highlight to mid-tone to shadow, you just gain one stop after how many years? After 8 years. Just one stop. And your focusing. Two major things is that the video focusing is faster and the eye focusing, that's pretty revolutionary. But after 8 years, I'm pretty sure you know how to focus on the eyes. But that's it, if you use low F number, yes, I agree with you. One of the biggest problems that I get with the older camera is that the longer you use it, they tend to get this back focus issue with a specific lens that you always use. So one of my biggest dilemma is that I go as low as f2.8 or f2, and then I put my focus point in the center, and I do a focus lock, recompose on the eye, and come back down, bam, I will definitely be out of focus. I agree with you. That is one of those times where eye focus is important. True, isn't it, Yichong? Come to think of it. So how do I overcome this? I keep moving the focus point. But I'm a studio photographer. Me being able to take my sweet time to do things will actually make me get paid more. But if you are not a studio photographer, you're an event photographer, and you shoot in functions, or you do sports photography, or street photography is your forte, then this would be a key evaluation point if you want to upgrade the focusing speed. I know what you're thinking now. You're thinking that, oh, what if they increase the megapixel of my camera? Well, let's look at these three models now. Notice that they don't show much improvement. But then I know what you're thinking. The more modern, super near-medium format 50 and above megapixel sensors, of course, they are sharper. But with one condition, when you start adding light, otherwise you're going to end up with more noise. But make no mistake, when your sensor size doesn't increase, they are not going to be medium format sensor size, but you get medium format number of megapixel. So you may get sharper picture, but you need to add lights. Apart from that, one of the biggest question is, why these three models, for the past 8 years, the megapixel doesn't increase? You must be wondering. Simple, you have more than enough. Well, I must admit, when you have megapixels that high, it's pretty useful. But the bigger question is, where do you use these photos? I mean, where do you upload them? Well, very simple. If you're a professional photographer, there are two types of professional photographers. The first type is that you shoot and then you send it to designers or other creative professionals that's going to be working with your photos. So if you are this kind of professional photographers, then you give the highest megapixel that your camera produce. But if you're going to be making wedding albums and photo books and you're doing them yourself, or your editor or assistants are doing them, then you don't need such a high megapixel most of the time. It's just overkill. Not even when you're printing a billboard that big. Because I think that's an interesting topic. When your billboards are big, you don't need high megapixel. Well, bet you didn't know that. You thought that the bigger the billboard, the more megapixel that you need. We should do a premium courses on this. Now back to the choice of megapixel. But if you are an unprofessional or professional that just share your work artistically, creatively on modern websites like this, Facebook, Pinterest, or any of this, you must know that all these sites would trash your pixel. What do I mean? Well, let's look at these CDNs. They're called Content Delivery Network. If you go to Facebook, if you pay attention to the bottom of your browser, you actually see this strange name called Akumai. Well, there are a few content delivery networks. I'm sharing with you this because you need to understand how this works, because one of these days, when you become a professional photographer, you'll be dealing with them. Example, if you go to beyond.photos, our e-learning website, when you submit photos to our gallery, it looks like it goes to our gallery. It doesn't. It goes to Upload Care, a pretty good CDN, content delivery network, that will store all these images for us. They're not cheap. If you submit a photo which is 13 or 15 MB, the first thing you'll do is you'll trash all these pixels to only this much, maybe 200 over KB. That's a scary jump. So what the content delivery networks or all these servers are doing is saying that, well, your viewers viewing on a browser needs it fast, needs them small, you don't need all these megapixels. So your 50 megapixel photos just went down the drain. So if you go to Facebook and share your beautiful photos, they still look kind of okay. But if you are an artistic photographer, like I say, and you want to print them and hang in a gallery or show in a very nice high megapixel screen, then yes. So in conclusion, megapixel has never been that much of an issue for me. Even anything that's above 24, I would say is good enough. Do you agree, Chong? Yeah. But when it comes to video, yes, the video resolution is something that we need to discuss about in your choice, should you upgrade. And the modern cameras that you're going to be buying soon or evaluating to buy are hybrid cameras. That means they shoot photos and also videos, because the modern hybrid cameras advance a lot on two things. The video resolution, which can go up to 4K and even 8K now, right? That's a lot of screen real estate. Let me explain to you why that is good. And also the FPS. They can easily do 100. And if you look at the latest Canon, it can do high resolution and also high frame rate. That's a beauty. You must be thinking, why is the ability to shoot slow motion that important? Let me just quickly show you some exciting videos that we did recently that depended a lot on 100 frames per second. Now you notice that there's a lot of speed ramp in there. That means it slows down and then it picks up speed. That's going to make your video pretty cool. It's quite in demand these days to shoot videos like this. But you need to shoot at 100 frames per second. Now there's another thing. You notice that we zoom in and out a lot to give it the illusion that the camera moved. The camera did not move. What you're doing is that you're zooming in during editing. That gives you that whip thing. But you notice that when you don't have enough resolution, they're going to end up pixelated like this. So if you are a video and a photographer, and the world demands this, that if you're a photographer, you should know video. And that's it. That brings us to a very important point before we finish this lesson. Did your skill improve that much to warrant an upgrade? Number one, take a look at the photos that you shoot 10 years ago. If you don't have the photos that you shoot from 10 years ago, you don't need to upgrade. That means you're not shooting that much and you're not even bothered to keep the photos that you have shot 10 years ago. That means you're a lousy photographer. Don't upgrade unless you're rich. Take a look at these photos. Take a look at the series that you shot. And out of that, how many good photos that you get? Let's say you shoot this angle, this composition. You take 7 shots, you get 2 nice ones. That's 2 out of 7. And then fast forward to where you are now. Take a look at another series or another collection that you shot. If the number has lowered here and increased here, then you have improved. That means that you take less shot to get nicer shots. If you used to shoot 3 days in a week, and then now you shoot 3 times in a quarter, you really need to upgrade. Third consideration, since your last purchase of a camera, did you expand on the genre of photographies that you shoot? You've been shooting portrait in 2010. You're still shooting portraits in 2020. That's fine. But you have added landscape and also product photography. That's an improvement. But if you're still shooting portraits and then now you're shooting portraits and perhaps business portrait, that's an improvement as well. In 2010, you're shooting your dog. In 2020, you're also shooting your dog. The only improvement is your dog. Okay, I'm going to ask you this last acid test question. It is now the third quarter of 2020. Very quickly, name me 3 skills that you learned in photography this year itself. Did you learn Lightroom? No. Did you learn how to increase the shadow tone in your portraits? No. Did you learn high-key portrait photography? No. Did you learn to manage reflection? Yes, that's one. So go through this list and ask yourself, how much have you learned this year and last year? If you clock more than 3 or 4, well done. I think you can safely go up to your spouse and say, honey, I'm gonna buy a new camera. So here's a last point, which is a very important point. This camera that you're owning now, when was it that you bought this? 2 years ago? That's a ripe time for you to resell it and buy another one. It's just like your notebook. The longer you cling on to your camera, the more it will devalue it, and you actually get just like $400 for this old camera. But if we stick to this plan of upgrade, every 3 years, I'm gonna sell this off, regardless whether I use it or not, you actually lose less. So have an upgrade plan. Use a camera no more than 3 years. And after that, sell it, don't lose that much, and quickly upgrade. You don't have to spend that much. The only problem that you have now is to explain to your spouse. Did you enjoy today's video? If you do, I invite you to head on to my website here and check out my e-learning courses, particularly the premium courses, because check out the price. This price is for a whole year of subscription where every week you get video lessons uploaded. And they include topics about cameras, lighting, stock photos, history of photography, portraits, whatever topic that you want to learn in photography. Even if you're new, we have a section that gets you started with photography correctly, and that's all in premium courses. And we have hundreds of video tutorials there already. An amazing price is just stunning. Grab this offer now before it ends soon. And speaking of which, you may want to check out the All Access account as well, because with All Access, you get access to premium courses, and not only that, you can enjoy all these lessons here of e-learning. These e-learning are specific on a topic, and this is truly a great deal. So check out premium courses and also All Access account. So I hope you show your support and love. Head on to my website.